بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إن شاء الله we're going to start from today till tomorrow and after tomorrow إن شاء الله pursuing our مجالس at the مجالس الحديث, the assemblies of hadith, selecting for you the most effective and beautiful hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We start with the hadith number 1312 under the chapter of At-Tawbah wal-Mawa'idh wal-Raqa'iq. Tawbah, repentance, Mawa'idh, advices and admonishing, Al-Raqa'iq, things that soften the heart. Yani, collection of imaniyat. Imaniyat, things that raise up your iman, which is very much needed. Very much needed. We start with the hadith number 1312, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أتاني جبريل فقال يا محمد عش ما شئت فإنك ميت وأحبب من شئت فإنك مفارقه وَعْمَلْ مَا شِئْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مَجْزِيٌّ بِهِ وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ شَرَفَ الْمُؤْمِنِ أَنَّ شَرَفَ الْمُؤْمِنِ قِيَامُهُ بِاللَّيْلِ وَعِزَّهُ إِسْتِغْنَاؤُهُ عَنِ النَّاسِ. Jibreel came to me, as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, and said, O Muhammad, live as much as you desire to live, for soon you're going to die. And love whom you desire to love, for soon you're going to split with, separate. And do whatever you want to do, for you'll be held accountable for what you do. And know well, or be aware, that the honor of the believer is his standing at night. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, they shun their beds. They shun their beds. Yani, at night, they shun their beds. They don't stay much on their beds sleeping. وَعِزُّهُ, and his dignity, استِغْنَاؤُهُ عَنِ النَّاسِ. Yani, his dignity is abstaining himself from begging and asking people. That's his dignity. His honor is by standing at night in prayer. His dignity is to keep himself away from asking people. Asking is not always, is not haram, but it becomes haram. Some of the askings is haram, is hated, disliked. When you have a need, then you can ask people. But it's not, it is permissible, but it's hated. But it becomes haram when you ask people something that you have no need for, just to collect. That makes it haram. This hadith is very beautiful. This hadith is also a rebuttal against those who say, no, the Prophet is not dead, the Prophet is alive. And they may even charge you with kufr if you say to them that, no, the Prophet is dead. Well, the matter requires a bit detail. In terms of our life, no, the Prophet is dead. The Quran is so clear about that. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إنك ميت وإنهم ميتون وما محمد إلا رسول قد خلت من قبله الرسل أفإن مات أو قتل انقلبتم على أعقابكم. It's very clear. And this hadith is also very evident. Oh Muhammad, live as much as you want to live, for soon you are going to die. In terms of the barzakh, which is another system, different, totally different than this life, yes, the Prophet is alive. Not only alive, but even he's praying. So what is the difference? The difference, there is no link between us and him here. So no one will say, oh, you know, I can go to the Prophet's grave and I can speak to him and he can hear me. And they bring to you many confusing evidences. So if the Prophet cannot hear me, why do we say to him, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah? They start bringing their evidence in order to what? In order to Allah themselves saying, Ya Rasulullah, I ask you to intervene for me between you and Allah. But wait a minute, the companions didn't do it. I always remind you this. How many years Aisha remained alive after the Prophet's death? Something like 30 years. Where was she staying, living? In his house. Where was his grave? In his house. So she was living there. Yes. Is there any hadith that she said, I've spoken to the Prophet while he was in the grave and he spoke to me and he replied to me? No. Why? Why some people say, you know, I've spoken to the Prophet. The Prophet came to me and told me this and this and that. In the dream? They say, no, not in the dream. Where? While you were awake? Yes. MashaAllah. So you become Sahaba. You became the companion of Rasulullah. So if, for example, we see you, we say, Raziyallahu anhu. He is Sahabi Jalil. That's not true. This is false. Because suhbah, companionship, had been accomplished, finished. It's been sealed. It had been sealed by the death of the Prophet ﷺ. No one can come today and say, I am Sahabi. He's not going to say, I'm Sahabi. But if he says, I saw the Prophet in awakeness, then you should tell him, Mabruk. Congratulations, you became Sahabi of Rasulullah. You became like Abu Huraira. We have a big trouble in the world of Islam with these kinds of people. Anyway, so the hadith is very beautiful. Even the rhyme of the hadith, عِشْ مَا شِئْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مَيِّتَ أَحْبِبْ مَنْ شِئْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مُفَارِقُهُ اِعْمَلْ مَا شِئْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مَجْزِيٌّ بِهِ. This is not a normal hadith. Philosophers cannot bring hadith like that. Even if they were to gather themselves, to bring beautiful statements like this, they will never be able to do that. Hadith number 1313. I think we all know this hadith. Narrated by Abu Huraira, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَتَدْرُونَ مَنِ الْمُفْلِسِ. Do you know who is the Nicholas? You know the Nicholas? Who's the Nicholas? Bank thrift, they call him? Bankrupt? The one who has no more money. Zero. He declares his bankruptcy. No more money. Need to be given benefit from the government, no more money. So the Prophet is saying, you know who's the Nicholas? They said, the Nicholas is the one who has no more dinham, no more dinar. Now the Prophet didn't say no. The Prophet didn't say you're wrong. It's true. That's what it comes to the mind primarily. The one, the Nicholas is the one who has no more dirham, no more dinar. But the Prophet said, إن المفلس من أمتي, the necklace among my nation, من يأتي يوم القيامة بصلاة وصيام وزكاة. In another hadith, أمثال الجبال. The necklace of my nation is the one who comes at the day of judgment with much salah, zakah, siyam, as much as mountains. وَيَأْتِي قَدْ شَتَمَ هَذَا وَقَذَفَ هَذَا وَأَكَلَ مَالَ هَذَا وَسَفَكَ دَمَ هَذَا وضرب هذا فيعطى هذا من حسناته وهذا من حسناته فإن فنيت حسناته قبل أن يقضى ما عليه أخذ من خطاياهم فطرحت عليه ثم طرح في النار. The necklace of my nation is the one who comes at the day of judgment with good deeds as mountains. He will be bringing with him much salah, siyam, salah. But he comes while he swore at this person, he insulted that person, he accused falsely this person, he had taken the money from that person. You know, there are people who say, oh, I need to borrow money. But you know, their intention is to spoil it. His intention is not to give back. And for such person, the Prophet ﷺ said, the one who takes people's money intending to spoil them, Allah will spoil him. أَتْلَفَهُ اللَّهُ. Allah will spoil him. But the one who takes people's money intending to give it back, Allah will pay it back for him at the day of judgment if he failed to pay it back when he was alive. See the good intention? It's very important. So, he had done this, he had insulted this person, accused falsely that person, took the money from that person. So this person, particular person, will be taking them back from his hasanat at the day of judgment. And the other one will be taken from his hasanat. And the other one will be taken from his hasanat. So, if he had no more hasanat to give, then he has to take from their sayyi'at. It will be thrown on him. The bad deeds of the people will be thrown on him, because he failed to pay back. Then he will be thrown in hell. What happened? Where are his salah, siyam, zakah? It's been given to them. Is that fair? Yes, he has to pay. Because the payment at the day of judgment will not be from the dirham or dinar, but it will be the currency, will be the hasanat and sayyat. That will be the currency that they have to pay. Don't think that if you did not pay back, you gained. La wallah, you're the loser. And he's the winner. Be careful. So this is the necklace, or bank thrift, as they say it in English. Hadith 1314. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اتركوني ما تركتكم. اتركوني ما تركتكم, يعني leave me as long as I leave you. You may not understand that. What does it mean? يعني don't investigate what I did not detail for you. Because if Allah did not detail an issue, it doesn't mean He forgot it. Deliberately, He doesn't want it to be detailed. Like, for example, the Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, إِنَّ اللَّهَ افْتَرَضَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْحَجَّ فَحُجُّ. Allah had made Hajj obligation for you, so perform pilgrimage. Then the man stood up and said, أَفِي كُلِّ عَامٍ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Is it an annual obligation every year, O Prophet? Is it obligatory every year, O Prophet? Alhamdulillah. The Prophet said, look at the beautiful statement of the Prophet. لَوْ قُلْتُ نَعَمْ لَوَجَبَتْ وَلَا مَا اسْتَطَعْتُ. If I said yes, then it will become obligatory. And then you won't be able to do it. Imagine if the Prophet, yes, obligatory on every Muslim every year. Imagine how many Muslims will be in this narrow, small valley surrounded by the mountains. Now if it reaches 3 million, it will be a problem. How much more if it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. Yes, it is true that the ummah at the time of the Prophet was not more maybe than 100,000 or 200,000. But Allah knows that this ummah will turn to become 2 billion. And imagine if the Prophet said, yes, obligatory every year. So 2 billion people must be there. So the question was not good. And the Prophet ﷺ, well, gave the answer. لو قلت نعم لوجبت ولما استطعت. So he's saying, leave me as much as long as I have left you. فإذا حدثتكم فخذوا عني. If I narrated to you something, if I spoke to you something, then take from me. فإنما أهلك من كان قبلكم بكثرة سؤالهم واختلافهم على أنبيائهم. What had perished those that had passed before you is their extreme or multi-questioning. Yani, for example, when someone told them that Musa was ordered to hit the rock by his stick, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala broke through a hole that caused the water to gush. Now, some of them asked, what was the color of the stick? Some say, brown. No, you're wrong. It was green. No. And they may fight for the cause of knowing what is the color of the stick, which is not obligatory to be known. And sometimes we differ about something which is not obligatory to be known. It may be something maybe advisable, but the unity of the ummah is obligatory. So don't seek what is not obligatory to spoil something which is obligatory. That's not wise. And what is worst is that the person brings an innovation, bid'ah, and he causes people to fight because of that. Some say, we disagree with it. Some others say, we agree with it. And that causes division. I always say that you cannot dictate people on submitting to your bid'ah. But if you bring a sunnah to them, they must submit to it. They're obliged to submit to it. So who's the real causer of the division? The one who brings an innovation. He is the sinner. He caused the division. If someone said, I disagree with it. You know, some people said, don't speak against these kinds of innovations that we grew up with. Shh, keep quiet. If you do, you're going to cause fitna. The real causer of the fitna is the one who keeps following this innovation and dictate people on following it. This is the real causer of fitna. The one who denounces and objects against innovation and shirk is not the causer of fitna. So the Prophet also had given us one of the causes of the perish of those who had passed before us. That they keep asking, for example, Musa said to the people of Israel, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تَذْبَحُوا بَقَرَ. Look at their nature. قَالُوا ادْعُ لَنَا رَبَّكَ يُبَيِّن لَنَا مَا هِي. What kind of cow is that? Leave Musa, as he left you, he didn't say to you, Allah is ordering to slaughter a cow, that the type of it is such and such. He didn't give details, so don't ask for details. So he said to them then, as a punishment, لا فارض ولا بكر عوان بين ذلك. Not this type, not that particular type. Go and search for it. Then, قالوا ادع لنا ربك يبين لنا ما لونها. Then they said, oh, ask your Lord, what is the color of the cow he wants us to slaughter? Why do you have to ask this? Okay, is that what you want? When they ask, Allah makes it more difficult on them as a punishment. Safra. But not only safra. This is yellow. Faqi'un lawnu. This is faqi'un lawnu. Do you see that? This is faqi'un lawnu. It's not only yellow. What do you call that color? Huh? Shining yellow. It's not only yellow. Tasurru an-nadhiri. Its color amazes the people's sight. So leave the Prophet as he. This is a methodology in itself. This is wisdom. This is the blessings of following the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Don't ask what had not been detailed for you, for Allah did not detail it a cause of forgetfulness. Coming to hadith number 1315, عن عبادة بن الصامت رضي الله عنه, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used him, استعمله على الصدقة. ثم قال له اتق الله يا أبا الوليد. He said to him, when he used him for the treasures of the sadaqah, the storage, the collection of the charity money, he said, fear Allah, O Abu al-Walid. أن تأتي يوم القيامة ببعير تحمله على رقبتك. Fear Allah, that you may be coming at the day of judgment while you are carrying a camel on your shoulder. That means if someone takes something, he must bring it at the day of judgment while he is carrying it on his shoulder. Let those governors of the Muslim world who smuggle trillions of money and store it in credits in Switzerland and Canada, let them hear this hadith and see how much responsible they will be at the day of judgment. The leader is responsible. Umar radiallahu anhu put his hand in the hole of the injury of a cattle. And he said, even this, I'm afraid Allah will be asking me about it at the day of judgment. Even the injury of a cattle, of an animal, even this injury of that animal, I'm afraid that Allah may ask me about it at the day of judgment. No. Hadith number 1317. عن سهل بن أبي حثمة قال سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول اجتنبوا الكبائر السبع. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, avoid the seven major types of sins. Then the Prophet kept silent for a while. Then he said, ألا تسألوني؟ ألا تسألوني عنهن؟ Shouldn't you be asking me about them? The seven major sins. الشرك بالله. الشرك بالله. Setting partners with Allah. See, the Prophet made this number one, which is the worst sin ever. That is to set up partners with Allah. Everything is hopeful as long as you die as muwahhid. Everything still hopeful. You still have a hope if you died as muwahhid, one who worship Allah alone, sincerely, purely. You know those who say, Ya Rasulallah, as'aluka shafa'ah. They are contradicting the conditions of La ilaha illallah. Wallahi. Even if they say La ilaha illallah, wallahi they are contradicting the essence of La ilaha illallah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. Whatever you are enjoying a favor, it's from Allah. ثُمَّ إِذَا مَسَّكُمُ الضُّرُّ فَإِلَيْهِ تَجْأَرُونَ. Then when the hardship strikes you, then you raise up your heads and shouting, crying to him, تَجْأَرُونَ. That means making a voice that resembles the sound of a cow. Allah! Raising your voices like that. ثُمَّ إِذَا كَشَفَ الضُّرَّ عَنْكُمْ إِذَا فَرِيقٌ مِّنْكُمْ بِرَبِّهِمْ يُشْرِكُونَ. Then when Allah releases this suffer and hardship away from you, some of you return to commit shirk with Allah. لِيَكْفُرُوا بِمَا آتَيْنَاهُمْ فَتَمَتَّعُوا فَسَوْفَ تَعْلَمُونَ. So they had, by this denying, they'll be denying the favor of Allah. So enjoy a little. Then you will see after that what's going to happen. See the word Allah in this verse, he combined two verdicts in this ayah, shirk and kufr. ثُمَّ إِذَا كَشَأَ وَمَا بِكُمْ نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ إِذَا مَسَّكُمُ الضُّرُّ فَإِلَيْهِ تَجْأَرُونَ ثُمَّ إِذَا كَشَفَ الضُّرَّ عَنْكُمْ إِذَا فَرِيقٌ مِنْكُمْ بِرَبِّهِمْ يُشْرِكُونَ لِيَكْفُرُوا. Two judgments in this ayah regarding those who ask someone other than Allah. And if you say that to some of those people, they say, oh, you're Wahhabi, we know you. Oh, we know you. Yeah, we know who you are now. Wahhabi? Wahhabi, yani I belong to Al-Wahhab. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Wahhab. Wahhabi, yani granter. You know something with Wahhab? Wahhab means a granter, the granter. And this is one of the names of Allah, Al-Wahhab. They refer me to Allah, they say Wahhabi. Just like they call me, for example, Rabbani. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَكِنْ كُونُوا رَبَّانِيِّينَ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تُعَلِّمُونَ الْكِتَابِ وَبِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَدْرُسُونَ. The one who teaches people the basics, the alphabetical knowledge, gradually to people, as Ibn Abbas said in Bukhari, he deserves to be called Rabbani. Who's the Rabbani? Al-Rabbani. He is the one that guides people to Ar-Rabb, subhanahu wa ta'ala, giving them the minor knowledge in steps before the major one. That's what Ibn Abbas said, and that is in Sahih al-Bukhari. So Rabbani, Wahhabi is just like Rabbani. So why do you use the name of Allah falsely? You are putting people down by using the name of Allah against them. What is that? It's because of the ignorance. Jahl! Are you better than them? Do you pray behind them in Mecca? You know, this man, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, after he had been granted victory, because in the peninsula 300 years, it returned to the shirk. People started to seek blessing from a tree, from the wali, from the graves, and this man came to object against all of that, and he returned people to the sunnah and tawheed of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why do you have to go against him? And after that, right after that, from that time and until today, those whom you call them Wahhabi, Allah had granted them victory, and they are still supervising the two harams of Mecca and Medina. Don't tell me that Allah doesn't like them, but they forced Allah's will. You can't say that. You can't say that. Type, okay, if what you say is true, for three centuries, Allah could not take them away from his two harams, unless you are wrong, not them. So, ash-shirk, that's the first sin. Ash-shirk billah, second. Wa qatlu an-nafs, third. والفرار من الزحف. الشرك بالله, you know it in English. قتل النفس, killing the soul without right. قتل النفس بغير حق. الفرار من الزحف, fleeing from the fight against your enemies. If a person is taking a back step in order to return stronger, there's nothing wrong with that. But to leave the battlefield of Jannah. You know, this battlefield is very dangerous. Tuck, 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 there's a fight. But at the same time, this is a place where you may achieve Jannah. So if you are a believer, you're supposed to be coming to the place, not running away and leaving it for life. For such people who do that, they will be punished severely at the Day of Judgment. That's why the Sahaba of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in one of the battles, the enemies were hiding, and they were good in in targeting people by their arrows. So suddenly they attacked, they ambushed the Muslim army. Tuk, 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 tuk. All of those arrows were launched on them, on the Sahaba. Naturally, the Sahaba have to run, but not yani run, go back to Medina, no. So they ran away, and they were called by the Prophet. They heard the Prophet saying, ya, ya kada, ya furan. Then they started to regather and come to the Prophet and say, Labbaik ya Rasulullah, they came. Then they were blaming themselves. They said, ya Rasulullah, nahnu al-farrarun. We are the runners away. Then the Prophet, look at the wisdom of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, "Bal antumul karrarun." He said, "No, you're not the runners away. You're not the fleeing people. You are the returning people." So the Prophet gave them apology, excused them for what they did, because naturally, when someone suddenly attacks you, you have to run, but not for good. No. You take a way to return back to your end. So there's nothing wrong with that. والفرار من الزحف وأكل مال اليتيم. And taking advantage of the orphan. Because the orphan cannot say to you, hey, what have you done with my money? He's small. Maybe it's 5 years, 4 years. So the one who eats the money of an orphan, this is one of the major sins. You have to maintain his heritage, his inheritance. You have to maintain it. You're responsible. Unless, for example, you work on that and you may take something very limited for making, because you dedicated yourself for, you know, for that. He has a lot of money. For example, he had inherited a lot of money. Okay, you may feed him, you may eat with him from the food. So inshallah, there's nothing wrong with that. But to take his money just like that, no. It's haram. وَأَكْلُ الرِّبَى. And eating. Not fool. Not shawarma. Not hummus. Riba! People today search for halal restaurant. When they see the logo halal, he's happy. But this man deals with riba. So he didn't search for this halal logo in terms of dealing with a bank? No, no, doesn't matter. You know what is the lowest rate or level of riba? The lowest level of riba is equal in sin, equal of one that committed already 36 times adultery. The lowest riba is equal of committing 36 adultery, fornication, or committing fornication with one's mother. That's what the Prophet said, authentically. The lowest rate of riba is equal of committing adultery 36 times or committing adultery with your mother, with one's mother, sorry. Allahu Akbar. It's horrible. وَقَذْفُ الْمُحْصَنَةِ قَذْفُ الْمُحْصَنَةِ يعني accusing falsely an abstinate woman. Is it abstinate? Not abstinate, يعني decent. Accusing a decent woman falsely. See that woman there? I've done something with her. Oh my God. That's horrible. Fraud. This is a major sin. وَالتَّعَرُّبُ بَعْدَ الْهِجْرَةِ What is التَّعَرُّب بَعْدَ الْهِجْرَةِ After you have immigrated for Allah and His Messenger, then you say, let me leave it. I get back to my Bedouin life. That was not allowed at that time. التَّعَرُّب بعد الهجرة. The companions saw a man subjecting himself to the killing in the fight. And they said, oh, this man is subjecting himself to perish. And Allah said, لا إله إلا الله. وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَ Don't throw yourselves to perish by your hands, by your own hands. Abu Ayyub al-Ansari interfered. And he said to them, Wallahi, I know when this ayah was revealed. It was revealed in a time after we have opened Makkah, al-Fatih. And we said, we people of al-Ansar, you people of al-Ansar, said, since we have supported the Prophet, mashallah, and this deen is becoming, mashallah, influential and flourishing, let's get back to our farms and take care of our lands again. Then Allah revealed this verse on His Prophet as a response for this. وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ So turning to life, apart from jihad and supporting Allah's deen and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is perishing in itself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be saying to the people of Jannah, O son of Adam, go ahead, farm your land in Jannah. Then one of the companions said, I bet that this person, you must find this person either from Quraysh or from Medina, Ansari, from Medina. Because those people are well, they are good farmers. They said, Wallahi la tajiduhu illa Qurashiyan aw Ansariyan. Because they were well known that they love to farm. And subhanAllah, it's beautiful that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, Dunaka ibn Adam, go ahead, son of Adam. Farm your beautiful land in Jannah. There's nothing that stops you. So when they heard the Prophet saying that, one of them stood up and said, I'm sure this person must be either Qurashi or Ansari. SubhanAllah. Now, coming to hadith number 1318. عن النعمان بن بشير قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول اجعلوا بينكم وبين الحرام سترة من الحلال. Keep between you and haram a fence, a barrier, a block, a shield of halal. Yani you know that this shield is halal in itself, but you don't come to it. Because you may, through this shield, if you step on it, you may fall in what is haram. So the best wari', the wari' is the one who keeps between him and haram a barrier of halal, to make sure that he keep himself away, to guarantee that he's staying away from what is haram. This is the meaning of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, اجعلوا بينكم وبين الحرام سترة من الحلال من فعل ذلك استبرأ لدينه وعرضه ومن أرتع فيه كان كالمرتع إلى جنب الحمى. Whoever does this, he had already guaranteed the innocence, the clearance of his religion and his honor. But whoever involved himself in it, is just like involving yourself in a protected area. You know, there are in the land, there is a forbidden zone. You know, sometimes they put fences and they say you're not allowed to, to what? To enter. It's not allowed place. So they put a fence. So Allah's don'ts, Allah's prohibitions, you should keep a fence between you and Allah's prohibitions, lest you fall in it. As the one who falls in that, in this farm, prohibited area, he may subject himself to be punished, even to be killed. So also, you should keep yourself away, put a fence between you and what is haram, a barrier of halal, lest you may fall in Allah's prohibitions that may cause you to be punished. In another hadith, 1319, he said, اجعلوا بينكم وبين النار حجابا. Set between you and fire hijab, a veil. That's why hijab is to cover the face, for example, to cover the head. We're not going to involve ourselves talking about covering the face. Is it obligatory? Is it etc.? It's agreed upon that it's highly recommended. But to say it is wajib, it is obligatory, I disagree with that. There are many evidences that at the lifetime of the Prophet, women used, not all women though, many women, they used to be showing their faces. And the Prophet didn't say, cover your face. You will never find any hadith. Never. You never find any hadith, cover your face. Never ever. Okay? But covering the face, you find some hadith that, for example, Aisha said, when men become close to us, we used to cover our faces. That's Allah. This is an evidence, but it's not evidence of the obligation. This is an evidence for the permissibility. It is not. Awra should not be shown in the prayer. Correct? Correct or wrong? Awra should not be shown in the prayer. Correct or wrong? Khalas? If it's awra, then the face becomes obligatory to be covered. Sorry?
For a woman, not for
a man. Tayyib, for sure.
So
I say,
woman.
Tayyib. Now, put between you and fire hijab. وَلَوْ بِشِقِّ تَمْرَ يعني a piece of a date, not the whole date though, a piece of a date can help in establishing a veil between you and hell. يعني fear Allah even through by a piece of date. Don't belittle giving, donating. Don't say this is a piece of date, who's gonna take it? Donate it if you can. Just do anything. Because of the Day of Judgment, when people will be facing fire, nothing will be helpful to you except your sadaqah today. Your sadaqah today will be your shield from hell at the Day of Judgment. So it's up to you. Do you want to widen this barrier between you and hell, or you want to make it small, little? Little donation, your shield will be at the Day of Judgment, little. More donation, your barrier will be bigger and bigger at the Day of Judgment. So seek to establish a big barrier between you and hell by giving more, by donating more. The best people in Allah's perspective are those who keep giving more and more, because this is more proof and more proof that this person is clinched to Allah and the hereafter. As-sadaqatu burhan, as the Prophet ﷺ said, the charity is a proof, is evidence. Evidence of what? That you believe in Allah and the hereafter. Because the one who believes in the hereafter, he knows that what you give today will be doubled for him at the Day of Judgment. It will be multiplied for him. Now, I think we stop here, inshallah. We continue tomorrow. So we have stopped at the hadith 1319. Jazakumullahu khairan wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Al-Wahhab is one of them, yes.
Yeah.
So they should not be.
Yeah.
This is a mistake. This is a big mistake. It's based on the jahl, ignorance of people. And I think it's started by the French people. They have a book called, very old book, 300 years. It's called L'Histoire des Wahhabis, in the history of Wahhabis. So they are the one who started it.
Someone to answer them, this, that they say, yes, Wahhabis, no problem. This, we have no name of God.
Exactly.
They have to someone to,
exactly.
To smash it. With the,
not smash. Huh? Yeah, with evidence, yes. With the evidence.
With
not with the hand.
No, with book.
جزاكم الله خيرا. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، اشهد ان لا اله الا انت.